Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you for praying. I was thinking yesterday, as James and I were out in the driveway hacking at the ice, of winter when I was young, and my biggest concern then was the handmade knitted mittens that Grandma would make for us getting wet and cold because we were having a snowball fight. So Helen is going to come now and bring us a poem that kind of takes us back to those days and maybe gives us another way of looking and thinking about this season of the year.
With all this snow that we've had, it just reminded me of my childhood. I went to a country school, so this was the things that we did almost every day, I think. It's called recess. Recess was a fun time, a toboggan ride for four, racing fast down the hill, walking back. What a chore. Fox and goose was our game, a circle we would make. We would run around and round, never thinking of a break. How we liked snow angels, all lying in a row. Oh, what fun it was for us. We'd make a dozen or so. Our mittens and our clothes were wet. We didn't care a bit. We were having so much fun, no time for us to sit. Soon the bell was ringing, time for us to go. Our recess time was over. We'd line up in a row.
And I want to encourage you, Special Ministry is mostly music, but it doesn't need to be music. And just as Helen has done for us, the reading of a poem or any kind of inspirational thing would also be a welcome thing. So thank you, Helen. Yeah. I don't know where my attitude toward winter changed, but I don't view it as friendly as I used to.
Me neither.
No, me neither. No. Okay. Well, we're going to read our scripture for the day, and then we'll welcome Sharon, who will also come and bring a special ministry with song. So let's open our Bibles to Genesis chapter 4, verses 1 to 6. And appropriate for the day, we're going to read the account of the first murder in the history of the world. The reading is on page 7 of the Pew Bible. This is after they had been ushered out of the Garden of Eden, and verse 1 says, "Now Adam had sexual relations with his wife Eve, and she became pregnant. When she gave birth to Cain, she said, 'With the Lord's help, I have produced a man.' Later, she gave birth to his brother and named him Abel. When they grew up, Abel became a shepherd, while Cain cultivated the ground. When it was time for the harvest, Cain presented some of his crops as a gift to the Lord. Abel also brought a gift, the best portions of the firstborn lambs from his flock. The Lord accepted Abel and his gift, but he did not accept Cain and his gift. This made Cain very angry, and he looked dejected. 'Why are you so angry?' the Lord asked Cain. 'Why do you look so dejected? You will be accepted if you do what is right. But if you refuse to do what is right, then watch out. Sin is crouching at the door, eager to control you, but you must subdue it and be its master. One day, Cain suggested to his brother, "Let's go out into the fields." And while they were in the field, Cain attacked his brother Abel and killed him. Afterward, the Lord asked Cain, "Where is your brother? Where is Abel?" "I don't know," Cain responded. "Am I my brother's guardian?" But the Lord said, "What have you done? Listen, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. Now you are cursed and banished from the ground, which has swallowed your brother's blood. No longer will the ground yield good crops for you, no matter how hard you work. From now on, you will be a homeless wanderer on the earth." Cain replied to the Lord, "My punishment is too great for me to bear. You have banished me from the land and from your presence. You have made me a homeless wanderer. Anyone who finds me will kill me." The Lord replied, "No, for I will give you a sevenfold, punishment to anyone who kills you." Then the Lord put a mark on Cain to warn anyone who might try to kill him. So Cain left the Lord's presence and settled in the land of Nod, east of Eden. May God's Spirit give us wisdom to understand these words and let them change our living. Put that on the back burner for a moment. Sharon, come and inspire us with the Word of God and song.
Believe him and know.
Scripture, Genesis chapter 4, is pretty sparse on the details. I don't know if you're the kind of person that likes a mystery, and you read mystery novels or watch shows that are detective shows or police shows where they're solving a mystery every week. This account would not satisfy if you were that kind of person and you had that kind of interest, because it's just very matter of fact. We need to look what the rest of Scripture tells us about this event to kind of fill in the details. So let's start there. On your notes, jot down this reference, 1 John chapter 3, verses 12 to 15. 1 John chapter 3, verses 12 to 15. And here we're going to see that John is using Cain as a negative example. Here's what he wrote. This is the message you have heard from the beginning. We should love one another. We must not be like Cain, who belonged to the evil one and killed his brother. And why did he kill him? John is going to tell us. Because Cain had been doing what was evil, and his brother had been doing what was righteous. So don't be surprised, dear brothers, if the world hates you. If we love our brothers and sisters who are believers, it proves that we have passed from death to life. But a person who has no love is still dead. Anyone who hates another brother or sister is really a murderer at heart. And you know that murderers don't have eternal life in them. As you can tell from that quotation, one of John's purposes in his letter is to call the church, call the believers to love one another. And he says, don't be like Cain. And he tells us why, in telling us why we shouldn't be like Cain, he gives us some insight into why Cain did what he did, and some backstory that says Cain did it because Cain was evil. He did not pursue righteousness. And that was a sign that he belonged to the evil one. The other scripture I'm going to look at very briefly with you is Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 4. Hebrews 11 verse 4. Now that chapter of Hebrews we refer to as the Faith Hall of Fame. And there, Paul, I believe the writer of Hebrews, lays out several examples that we should follow. And he says in verse 4, it was by faith Abel brought a more acceptable offering to God than Cain did. Abel's offering gave evidence that he was a righteous man, and God showed his approval of his gifts. Although Abel is long dead, he still speaks to us by the example of his faith. So isn't it interesting how in John we have Cain offered to us as an example to avoid, and now here in Hebrews we have Abel offered to us as an example to follow. That there was before this incident, not mentioned in the scripture in Genesis 4, a long division between these two brothers. This was not an isolated incident, but instead came at the long experience of years where Cain did wrong and Abel did right. What we're going to see in this scripture this morning, friends, is this very simply, that God calls us to be our brother's keeper, not his killer. We're to respect and value human life, as I said earlier, because God said so. And we have here the terrible things that come about when life is not held sacred. When we look at the text, we're going to ask or note three things. The first is a question. What's in a name? Well, you know that in the Bible, people's names are always significant, and the meaning of their name is always indicative of what happens to them. A very few exceptions to that rule. So the name Cain means brought forth or acquired. Brought forth or acquired. And maybe Eve chose that name to show gratitude to the Lord. We don't know why that name was chosen. But the next one, Abel, we have a little bit more insight into. Abel means breath or vapor. And in the Bible, it is used as a symbol of things that are insubstantial or quickly gone. And in that sense, the name Abel is a kind of prophecy and also a kind of comment on life in general. First, in terms of a prophecy, there may have been some revelation to Eve that Abel was too good for this world and he would not be long in it. And so maybe she chose that name as an indication of that. But also, Abel's name may have been just a general comment on the brevity of life. Life is short. We say it lots, don't we? Life is short. I don't know how Eve would have known that because they're the first people. But again, I think God simply spoke to Eve and she brought forth these names. We see already a difference in these two sons of Adam and Eve. Now we're going to look secondly at this passage to note the difference that made all the difference in verses 2 to 7. Now when we look at chapter 4 and verse 3, what we see is that it's harvest time. And the text tells us that Abel brought forth a sheep and Cain brought forth some produce from the land. Abel became a shepherd, Cain became a farmer. And there is no mention made at this point of the difference in the offerings. So the point of this passage clearly is not about what was offered, but about how it was offered. And we might take a look at the order in which it was offered. Abel's offering is listed first. And remember, there is no religion here. There is no scripture, there is no law, there is no organization. Everything is new. And so it's possible, and I would argue even likely, that Abel, because we've learned he was a righteous man, had a spontaneous and sincere desire to give back to God. I think Abel decided in his heart that God had been generous with him. And he wanted to honor God. Thank you. And then Cain's offering. And again, we're reading into the text here. It doesn't say any of these things, except from the New Testament, we know that Cain had always been doing wrong. And so maybe he offered his offering in imitation, not sincerely, not from his heart, maybe begrudgingly. Now, we don't know also from this text how they understood that Abel's offering was accepted and Cain's was not. But there's a hint in the text in the fact that the word translated as accepted here in our New Living translations can also be translated as kindled, starting a fire. And so it's possible that when Abel offered his sacrifice, fire came down from heaven and consumed the offering. Now, if you're Cain and you're looking at that and you go, wow, that's cool. I want to see if that happens for me. Is that a good motive for making an offering to God? Not really. We don't know. We're guessing. But what is obvious in the text is that Cain became very angry. And the text says his face was dejected. You know, the pouty face. We're angry. We don't care who knows it. And we go about with an angry expression on our faces. Now here's the first time God confronts Cain. And he does so to give him a chance to repent. And I think the centerpiece of this passage is not the offering, it's any of the other details. It's God giving Cain every opportunity to do the right thing, and he steadfastly refused to do the right thing. Look at verses 6 and 7. Now let me tell you something about the Bible. God never asks questions because he needs information. Right? If you look back at chapter 3, verse 9, Adam and Eve had just sinned against God, and God comes to them in the cool of the evening. He says, Adam, where are you? Did God not know where Adam was? God has the hairs of his head counted. He knows how many leaves he's standing on, how many blades of grass are beneath his feet. God is not uncertain about Adam's location. God is trying to draw him out. And so here, God approaches Cain and he says, why are you mad? Why do you look so angry? And he told Cain why his offering had not been accepted. He said, you will be accepted if you do what is right. Now remember, the author of John said he never did what was right. If you do what is right, then your offering will be accepted. But if you refuse, watch out. Now you think, right, when God approaches you and says, watch out, you might take notice of that. How stubborn do you have to be to look upon God and say, now, I don't care for your warning. I'm not going to listen. I'm going to do my own thing. God promised Cain if he did what was right, his next sacrifice would be accepted. God was fair. Abel did right, and his sacrifice was accepted. And he says to Cain, look at Abel. If you did like Abel did, you'd be accepted. If you fail to do right, worse troubles befall you. And here God also coaches take on his human nature, because human nature is a new thing, right? And we're learning how to be people. And he says, if you refuse to do what is right, watch out. Sin is crouching at your door. I just have to smile at that a little bit. Had doors been invented yet? Evidently. He said, here's what human nature is like. You have appetites to do wrong. You have tendencies to be selfish. And it's like an animal crouching at the door of your home. If you open the door and let it in, there'll be trouble. He said, however, you can subdue that animal outside the door. You can master your own human nature. You can have self-control. Now, God said all of these things to Cain, and apparently they went in one ear and out the other. So we notice three then, the ultimate crime for the first time, starting in verse 8. Now, one day, Cain suggested to his brother, let's go out into the fields. You realize that that's Cain getting Abel onto his turf, literally. Come out of the pasture, Abel. Hey, let's get out of the house. I got something I want to show you. The text does not go into any of the details about how the murder was committed. But this fact alone convicts Cain of premeditation. This was not a crime of passion. He didn't go out and talk with Abel and on just a routine errand, just walking around and suddenly fly off the handle. No, this was planned. It was callous. It was cruel. It was cold-hearted, premeditated murder. Now, here comes God. Verse 9. Afterward, the Lord asked Cain, where is your brother? God knows where his brother is. Where is Abel? He's trying to draw Cain out. He's trying to give Cain a chance to repent again. And what does Cain do? He takes a stupid pill and answers the question with a question. He gets all defiant. Who should I know? Am I my brother's keeper? You know the worst part of that is, the answer is yes. Yes, you are your brother's keeper. And that's what the New Testament says to us consistently. We are here for each other. We are here and are to be concerned about the safety and security and the spirituality of our brothers and sisters first and foremost. Yes, we are each other's keeper. So Cain said the first stupid thing that came to his mind, and it condemned him all the more. Verse 10, God judged Cain and found him guilty. I think you can hear the heart of God broken here. What have you done? Listen, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. Cain was a selfish brute, an unrighteous man who thought he could defy God and get away with it. But the blood of his brother gave silent testimony to his awful crime and condemned him. So in verses 11 and 12, God passed sentence. Cain was cursed. Exiled. Cursed and exiled in verses 11 and 12. The curse is much like the one that Adam brought upon himself in Genesis chapter 3, verses 17 to 19. The earth itself will reject him. His attempts to grow crops will end in frustration and failure. Cain had lost his job and lost his brother. That's the curse. The banishment is that God made him a homeless wanderer for the rest of his life. Now, too late, Cain expresses regret, but not repentance. You see, regret is something that should lead us to repent. That we feel sorry for our sins and we have remorse for what we have done, and so we are motivated to say to God or to the person whom we have offended, "I am so sorry. Will you please forgive me?" But not Cain. What's he regret? He regrets being punished. He regrets being judged. He regrets being found guilty, and it's way too late for that. And it's the wrong kind of regret. And he's worried now for his safety of all things. Who's going to kill Cain? This isn't a logical statement that he's making here. And so God's answer to Cain is to give him a mark in verses 15 and 16 as a warning to any who might try to avenge the blood of Abel. And I want to challenge you today, friends. Whatever physical form that mark took, it was a mark of grace. We typically think of it as a mark of condemnation of Cain's guilt, but Cain deserved to die. And yet God spared his life. And so that mark, whatever it was an act of grace on God's part that he should not be punished, that he should not be punished with death. In fact, God said, "I will warn a sevenfold punishment should anyone entertain any notions of killing you." And in that, friends, we see here yet another way that God is calling us to hold human life sacred. When in his grace, he said to the first murderer, "You will not be killed." Here's a mark that will keep you safe. Here's a mark that will allow you to live. And in so doing, God indicated that human life is sacred to him. And even a murderer's life should be sacred to us. Because we are our brother's keeper. Our sister's keeper. Not their killer. In his teaching, Jesus said that hating is akin to murder. That same thing was repeated in the passages that we read earlier. And that condemning one another puts us in jeopardy of hellfire. It's easy for us to claim innocence on the basis of never having been guilty of murder. But none of us are innocent of the crime of hatred. The fact is, Cain's love was misplaced. He loved himself more than Abel. He loved himself more than his parents. He loved himself more than God. And self-love was the cause of his anger at what he perceived to be God's unfair acceptance of his brother's offering and not his own. His perverse self-love caused Cain to defy God and failed to repent at every opportunity that God gave him. Out of proportion, self-love is the root of all Cain's sins. So friends, this is the thing about which we must be careful. This is the thing about which we must be vigilant and guard against a self-love that is so complete that no other life counts. Respect for life begins with a humble and correct understanding of love for self, of valuing God first, others second, self last. Then we respect life. Amen. What have we decided today? We decided to follow Jesus. Let's express that decision then as we take our hymnals or bulletins, stand, and sing 602. Go in grace now as you do that very thing. Amen.